In my own case, I have been asked, therefore, if the sisters are not going to be present, because we do live in a different day. And I have memories now since the 60s. There are always one or two sisters who were in those brothers' meetings. They're liberated. They won't go, what's going on with those? I'm going to go, what do you think? I was much brighter than you about that. I don't know what you're doing. So one of the things we've done is we've had to back away from decision making in the brothers' meetings and just airing problems and not doing anything about them. And the other thing is, I try to meet with the sisters once a month and tell them everything I can remember that's going on and let them talk with me. Now, Gene, you're not always there, that's true, and what do you do? And the answer is, somebody else needs to do that. About once a month, there needs to be a time. And then we have brothers' meetings, we have sisters' meetings, and then sometimes we do have persons' meetings. A persons' meeting? I'm surprised you didn't catch that. There's a salesman, and then there became a salesperson. And we had person meetings. And brothers and sisters are both there. We have both, too. But I'd say, generally speaking, sisters don't split churches. Sisters don't split churches. And brothers have, what is that, testosterone? Something, whatever he said, which makes us warlike, aggressive, warlike, that's right. Sisters, bless their hearts, don't have this particular hormone, and the brothers are better at a place to them. Another problem with having brothers' meetings is some of the brothers begin to get the idea that the brothers' meetings is an elders' meeting. And I don't know what to do with those guys. They just are naturally hostile. They don't want leadership in the church. They are terrified when elders are appointed because they're afraid that suddenly they're going to have to be submissive to someone. I would say this to you, and I'm going to tell you two brothers from Atlanta and all the rest of you if you show up here. There'll be brothers' meetings. But those brothers' meetings are grace-given. They are not scriptural. And it's a privilege, not a scriptural right. It's not a right, it's a privilege granted. And again, there are times when you have to ask somebody to just stay out of the meeting. I've never had to do it yet, but I've come awfully close because he is just so antagonistic about everything. It's a privilege, not a right. Nonetheless, it is my own style, and I enjoy it. Well, that's not all we do. Most of what we do is worship the Lord. I'd rather be in a brother's meeting than in any meeting on this earth. God, people absolutely refuse to have church plans. They're going to let God do it. And God doesn't happen to work that way. Let me tell you something about your Lord. He is by nature hidden. You Pentecostals, you have a God who's everywhere. He's in the wind, the trees, and the cigarette smoke. That's a smoke over there, you know. And he's in the water, and he's in a song, he's in a vision, he's in this, he's there. You've got a God that just show up anywhere. And God told me this, and God told us that, we had a vision of, and this and that, and the other. Everybody's got a vision. Well, you've got a God that just springs up everywhere. I want you to look at just stand back and look at your God for a moment. Your God created this universe and left absolutely no proof that he exists. Now I want you, Christian, to put this into your pipe and smoke it up in there, that there is no proof for the existence of God. There isn't. There is no proof. Nobody's found one single shred of evidence for the existence of God. God works through men. He doesn't come down and suddenly become head of his church. This week, there will probably be somewhere between 50 and 500 and 1,000 experiences of church life. There will be probably 50 to 100 groups that will begin meeting this week out of a wonderful experience with the Lord, and every one of them will say, We'll make it. Others didn't. We will. Because God didn't let us down, bring us this far, give us all this, and do it. Man, have you overestimated your God?
Yeah.
He'll leave you high and dry. He'll just walk off and leave you. Flapping in the breeze, he will walk off and leave you. No, he doesn't leave any proof of his existence, and he doesn't show up very often. Do you not realize that your name is Believer? We are those who believe in the presence of no evidence. We are believers. I can't help it that God ordained church planters. And if you can't handle one, fine. But say goodbye to any permanent experience of church life, and I am still standing here, 56 years old. I've said this before, I'll say it now, I'll say it till the day I die. I've never seen an exception to it, and I never will. Those groups die. They die. They dissolve, and they die. I made that statement in this building a year and a half ago to a group of people who don't exist today. And they were very, some of them were very irate with me that it would not happen to them. In fact, I remember vividly three people sprang out immediately. But our situation is different. Maybe it was, but they don't leave anymore. Atlanta, Georgia. Yes, we don't know how to meet. Yes, we won't take responsibility. Yes, we're scared. Yes, we have no past experience in it. And yes, those are some of the things that kill us. But we don't have to die if there's someone to help. All right. Let me see. I had one. Let me go back to these meetings and look at them for a minute. Perhaps the most serious problem you face after the initial time of experiencing the Lord, if all things else are equal and well and running well, the biggest problem you face, when you don't have a ritual, God's people tend to come later and later and later and later until there is no meeting. You announce for 7:30, people come at 8 because no one's going to be there. 8:15, you start getting past 8:15 and people stop coming. And that is a responsibility you've got, and it is a problem for which I have never found a cure. And that's again why you need an extra local worker now and forever, world without end. You need somebody who will come in from the outside and turn things upside down, around, and backwards. And you want to hear my method? Boy, I'm giving away so many trade secrets this week. I will make an announcement that you better be there at 7 p.m. And if the majority of the church is not there at 7 p.m., I dismiss the meeting and send everybody home. That's one. Now, you better not do this, but I can. I can do this because this is the way it is. Two, I come in at 7 p.m., I walk to the front of the meeting, I get my Bible out, and I read a text and start preaching. When people come in, they are absolutely dumbfounded. And I'm halfway through the message, and they just got there. There's been no singing or praying or anything else. And number three, and this one is drastic, that the meeting is at 7 p.m., but we will lock the doors at 6:55, and no one can come in after that. And by the way, I'm open for suggestions. Those are three things I do, but I'll take any ideas you've got. I'll tell you something. About every 6 months to a year, the church has to be put back together again all over when she is not following ritual and form, and when she has no people to lead her in the meetings. She has to be put back together again about every 6 months to a year. It's got to be done. And that is so scriptural, and that is so New Testament. And why can we not awaken to this? I don't mean it totally falls apart, but it's like a piece of clay that begins to melt. You made this beautiful pot. You look at it about a year later, and about half that pot's oozed out over the table, and maybe one of the handles on it's fallen off. And it's not going to hold water much longer. To me, this is a joy. This is a wonderful thing. A good, wonderful, glorious resurrection and change of direction about every year. Boy, it sure is hard on people who are set in their ways. A home is constantly undergoing revision, isn't it? One of my brothers and sisters trying to pump a meeting up. Well, I think when we start pumping a meeting up, and I'm not opposed to seeing that happen from time to time, but when it becomes what you're doing every week, it is time you change the way you meet. You got to do something different. You got to stop whatever you're doing. Generally speaking, we ought not to pump up a meeting. It is usually a sign of problems coming. There is an element of leadership that will be in every meeting. And all I can say to you is it's there and it's probably natural. There's not much you can do about it. But the church will reach a point where it becomes, and I'm using this word, it's not a good word, but I'm using it in a positive sense, will become addicted to its meetings without human leaders and will fight to keep that privilege. Community has a tendency to make us dependent upon the community, and we lose our individual relationship to the Lord. Actually, we don't lose our individual relationship to the Lord. What we do is we stop taking responsibility for our own lives and start looking to somebody else. All I can tell you is that I fight that tooth and toenail constantly. I bring it up. I remind people of it. Merrill, is that your name? I have never found a solution for this one. When people get so attached to one another that their friendship is more important than the Lord and His house. We have a saying down in Texas, if a dog ever starts stealing eggs, you can't break him. All you can do is shoot him. And that's true. You cannot break a dog from stealing eggs. Once he does, you're going to have to move him to the city where there are not any eggs. And I don't know what to do with Christians when they reach that point other than to tell them to, you know, go have their friendship the rest of their life. I try to shy away from encouraging the church to have church-wide prayer meetings. That's strange, isn't it? We tend to pick up one another's vocabulary. I always encourage you to have your own prayer life. I would encourage you in that. And to meet with one or two people and keep your own way of speaking. Watch language in a church. Hey, this is not a church's fault. It's not a leader's fault. I watch people come in and their attitude is, I want to be one with you. Show me what your vocabulary is. What do we believe? What's our vision? What's our goal? And I will become a fanatic at it. Just fill me in on the details and I'm ready to go. There are really needy people in this world who want to abdicate their responsibility to life and turn it over to someone else. I think one of my responsibilities and anybody else's is not give a whole lot of advice and not direct people. Now, I have a problem there. You want to hear one of Gene Edwards' problems? I'm a very enthusiastic person. You come up to me and start talking to me about something, and man, I'm going to just really encourage you on it. 5 years later, you come back and say, you told me to do that. I ask everybody, I'm going to be asking, I haven't had the privilege of doing this since I decided to ask, I would ask everybody, take from 1 to 2 months a year away from the church and a sabbatical. Now, I don't think a sabbatical ought to wait till 7 years. I think 4 is a much better idea. And just don't come. Go attend the Baptist church for a year. Don't get so much involved that you literally lose your mind into a larger mind of the community. I don't want to see people give up their individuality. I fight for it hard. It's one of the things I stand for. And I can't stand this business of courting little groups. I can't stand this business of picking up a certain vocabulary, having visions and goals, and a movement orientation. I can't stand head covering or authoritarianism. I just all vocabulary in order to ensnare, and I don't think the people who do it know it, but it's squid heads anyway. And now you suffered, and you lost everything. And my first emotion is, this is too terrifying. There's too many risks. Let's just not do anything. And then I have another feeling. I want to share it with you, Fanny. You had something, you lost it. You lost it because of men. But Penny, I'm not sure that's true. Behind men is Satan. And behind Satan is God. And ultimately, it was his will. Now, Father, you have something to give the kingdom of God. It's a testimony of don't lose your individual responsibility. And you see that a lot clearer than most of us do, even others who've lost it. Patty, the body of Christ needs that. Maybe not now. Maybe you're not ready. You still need some more healing, fine. But, Patty, don't ever forget that behind the cross and agony and pain is purpose. It always doesn't always get fulfilled, but there was purpose in everything. And as far as I'm concerned, you are a jewel of protection for the church. That, all right, you've suffered. You've seen something most of us are missing. Will we suffer as a body and continue having this lack? I hope not. I hope somewhere that testimony of yours will be valid for a people. I was often asked by the sisters, the young sisters, during the time of the Jesus movement, the young sisters would say, what is our place in the church? And my answer was always, when you are 40, you will tell me. You're going to grow up in the church, and when you're 40, you're going to tell me what the sister's place is in the church. If we could all understand that we're kind of worthless anyway till we get to be 40. Just to goodness, the first 20 years of your Christian life is for growing up. Those of us who are older will tell you that we left adolescence at 30, and we grew up at 40. And you don't know that, and you never will know it. And I used to hate old people who talked that way. Get out of my way, buddy. Just move out of my way. And I did, and they moved out of the way. And I have no regrets. But, well, I had a lot to learn of Jesus Christ that is spiritual, that is deep and profound, that cannot be learned in your 20s. It cannot be learned in your 20s. You're never going to learn the cross in your 20s. It can't be done. The cross doesn't stick in your 20s. You may meet it, but it don't stick in your 20s. It begins to stick a little in your 30s. Now, Patty, I was nice to you, wasn't I? And I have that to say to all of you who are getting older. Why in the world are you nursing all these pains you got from church life? Why don't you let it turn to gold, brother? Amen. But gold, not hyssop. There's nothing worse that can happen to a group of people than to have some old sourpuss walk in. We started in Portland, and we had to stop because some people came in, and literally, they were so terrified from their background that they stopped every meeting and corrected everybody, because every time we met, we were making errors that were going to get us in trouble, and they would grind every meeting to a halt with correction. One day, I just stopped, walked out, and left. It was impossible to meet. These are all people older than me. I believe it or not, I still respect people older than me. There are only 5 or 10 left. If you can let that thing turn to gold, it becomes a wonderful vessel for God. All right. If those of you listening to this tape, and those of you sitting in this room, look anything else, having a meeting in which you seek and put that meeting under the headship of Jesus Christ has its problems, friends. Boy, I wish somebody would explain to me how to get commitment to Christ out of the people of God. We will commit ourselves to anything but Jesus Christ. We'll commit ourselves to Him. Say amen. Amen. We'll, to a movement. The only reason you can get hurt is because you have a commitment that's misplaced. You need a commitment to the church, a ferocious commitment. And it should be local, but it has to be also universal. And I don't, you know, retreat that. The church as what she ought to be, should be, and so forth. You don't go off to the woods and lick your wounds for 10 years because you got hurt locally. Something is wrong with your commitment. There is no excuse for thousands of people leaving a movement destroyed unless you have been had hot poker stuck up your toenails and physically abused. Now that you've got excuses for. You can take 5 or 10 years off from that. But I know a brother who has been physically abused, and he hasn't stopped yet. And nothing stopped that brother. He spent over half of his Christian life in prison. From the day he was saved till this day, and he's, I think, a year older than I am. Over half his life's been spent in prison. He's never stopped. He didn't stop in prison. He didn't stop anywhere. I'll tell you something else about him. He is in a land where the Christian faith is outlawed, and in fact, the fact that he was the first Christian ever saved in his nation. And he went to jail. They finally quit throwing him in jail. Now he has the right to nurture his own. But missionaries are not allowed in there. And every time that he's sent to prison, Christian missionaries go and buy his followers with money. And he comes out and he doesn't have a follower left. Now, if there's a man on this earth living today who's got a right to be bitter, it's him. That man spent a week in my home. 1 week. I consider him maybe the greatest man of this century. And you never even heard of him. Probably never will. Spent about 15 or 20 years in prison at the hands of the government. And I asked him a question I've asked myself and other men who've been persecuted for the faith. I said, which hurts the most? Being put in prison? Even put in mental institutions. And can you imagine what a prison in Nepal would be like? Which hurt the most? Being thrown in prison by your government or what Christians have done to you? And his eyes flashed, and he said, there's no comparison. It's what Christians do to me. And he walks out of prison, and all of his Christians, all of his followers, people who led every one of them to the Lord, every one of them bought off by Christian missionaries who turned them against him. And he grabs his worn-out tools, and he starts all over again from zero. Hallelujah. Now there is a man after God's own heart. I sat and listened to that brother talk, and I cried like a baby. I felt so ashamed. Shoot. I have not yet suffered for my Lord. Nobody has mistreated me. I have not been abused. Not when I compare my life with his. Why are you hurt? Why don't you recognize these things are from the hand of God? They're all from the hand of God. Commitment? I don't understand how. Let me gripe a minute. I'm going to gripe a minute. I got saved on July 17th, 1949 or 50. I never can remember. It was the day before. I'm celebrating it today. I hadn't thought about that. The day before my 17th birthday. I was a junior in college, by the way, at that time. Saved in a graveyard. Got out there to be alone. And it was a wonderful day. Amen, Lord. How long? When was that? When did I get converted? Somebody figure it out. I'm going to be 56 tomorrow. So what year was that? Was that 49 or 50? I think it was 49. I'm not sure. Anyhow, how long have I been a Christian? Somebody figure this up for me. I never have thought about this. And people, I've been a Christian so many years. I don't have any idea. Anyway, from that moment till this minute, nobody has ever had to sit down with me and encourage me to go on with the Lord. There's been nothing that's ever happened in my life. And Gene, you got to get leave sin. Not that I haven't sinned. Gene, you know, come back to God. Come back. I spent half my ministry trying to talk people into staying followers of the Lord.